a seat at the table. It's what we call this series. And it's an opportunity to invite someone to come sit at a table that God invites them to. And as we look at closing this series, the idea is that as a church, of all people, we should be the ones inviting people that are far from God to come sit at the same table that we are comfortable sitting. Because it's easy to be in community with other believers. It's easy to be in community with people that think like me and look like me and act like me. But when was the last time you invited someone to your table that was different from you and was far from God? Because we can live in this Christian bubble. I'm guilty of it, right? It's easy to talk about Jesus. It's easy to talk about someone that has the same Holy Spirit that I do. But man, if there's somebody that doesn't look like me, act like me, and think like me, man, maybe I'm not so inviting to pull out a chair to invite them to a table. And so this scene in Luke 5, we see Jesus notices a man by the name of Levi who's sitting in a tax booth. And it says after this, and before we get into Levi's story, when you see in the Bible the words after this, you have to ask yourself, what preceded what is happening now in the story? So you go back and you read at the beginning of Luke chapter 5, it's Jesus, and he comes upon a man named Peter who's fishing. And they fished all night, and Jesus says to Peter, put out the boat a little so he can preach the word. And he's preaching to all of these crowds. And then he tells Peter, he says, look, drop the nets. And if you know fishing, you don't fish during the day. Back in Jewish culture, in the Sea of Galilee, you fished at night. And he says to Jesus, hey, Lord, I have toiled all night. We didn't catch anything. But he says, nevertheless, if you tell me to put down the nets, I will. And they had such a catch of fish that Peter had to call James and John to come over to help pull up. And it says, as they pulled up all of these fish, their boats began to sink. And Peter went to Jesus and he says, Lord, get away from me. I am a sinful man. And the Lord says to Peter, says, now you fish for actual fish, but I'm going to make you a fisher of men. And Peter, along with James and John, leave their boats, and they leave their fishing nets to follow Jesus. The chapter continues. Jesus is walking, and he sees this man full of leprosy, and that's where we'll end the study as a preview. And he heals the man who was completely covered in leprosy. He continues on. There's these four men who are bringing this paralytic friend that they have. And there's so many people around the house where Jesus is preaching. There's no room for them to go through the front door. So they drop the man through the roof right in front of Jesus. And Jesus says to the man, your sins have been forgiven. And he's chastised for it. He goes, the Pharisees and the teachers say, no one can forgive sins but God. And he says, what do you want me to say? Your sins are forgiven or to pick up your mat and walk? And I love Jesus. Jesus does both. He says, your sins are forgiven. And he tells him, pick up your mat and walk. And that man didn't leave the same way he walked in. Actually, he was carried in and he walked out. Can I get a hallelujah for the healing power of Jesus? And I would say the same for you today. We are many times like that paralytic man. We come in one way, but God wants us to go out another. And as we look at this story, Levi, it says, was noticed. I'm going to read verse 27 again. It says, after this, Jesus went out and saw a tax collector by the name of Levi sitting at his tax booth. Follow me, Jesus said to him. And Levi got up, left everything, and followed him. The word saw is that he noticed Levi in the tax booth. Now, tax collectors back in the day was hated by Jewish society. like tax collectors were collecting taxes for Rome. They were like the Roman IRS. Anybody love the IRS today, right? No one loves the IRS. Anybody ever sent the IRS an email? Thank you for the way you calculated the way that I owe taxes this year, right? Nobody does that. And tax collectors would not only collect the taxes that were due, but they would also charge a little over it, so they would actually extort money. So I want you to get this idea. Levi is not loved by the culture. And Jesus pays attention to him. So much so that this man decides to leave everything, wealth, lifestyle, everything that he's ever accumulated at this point to follow Jesus just by the simple words of follow me. And I was thinking about how do we notice people today? If you're like me, any fast walkers in the house, anybody? You could be honest in church today, it's 11 o'clock. Right, you're busy, you're going through life, you're going from one appointment to the next, your calendar is busy, you don't have time. And for me, it's not that I don't notice people, I don't slow down to see sometimes who God is placing right in front of me. Maybe God has placed people in front of you, and he's saying, I want you to show them the love of Christ. Are there people in the culture or in your sphere of influence that God wants you to notice that are different from you, that are far from God? And here's the thing. I want you to notice them without judging them. Because many times we look at the culture and we go, oh man, it's getting darker out here. But thank God for the light in church. But can I just say, we're not supposed to keep the gift of God. We're not supposed to keep the gospel. We're supposed to share the good news out there. Can I get an amen, somebody? We're not supposed to keep this gift to ourselves. We're supposed to share it out there without judgment. Why does Levi, which is Matthew, leave? His heart was ready. There was nothing that the tax collecting world could give him anymore. So he decides to leave for something only God can provide. And when we look at our invitation to people to sit at a table, it's to offer them only God, something that only God can provide, that he actually provided for us. But what's the first step when engaging people is we have to take down these walls that we put up. Sometimes that wall is judgment. I'm looking at this person. I know they're far from God, but man, the way they look, I don't know if I can invite them to my table. Here's the first point if you're taking notes. The table is a place for breaking down walls. And you must ask yourself this question. What are walls in my life that subconsciously that I put up that keep people from me and connected them to their need for Jesus? Where are those walls in my life that's causing me to miss opportunities to connect people with Jesus? The tax booth was a wall. But what are our walls today? Maybe sometimes our walls are, it's like, I want to sit at the table, and yeah, I hear you, Pastor, to invite somebody that doesn't look like me, doesn't think like me, but does that mean I have to sit at a table with an atheist? I don't have anything in common with an atheist. I mean, they don't believe in God. Why would I spend time across the table with somebody that doesn't believe in God? You know why? Because God also wants to save atheists. And he wants them to come to the knowledge of truth. Anybody ever heard of C.S. Lewis? Anybody know that author? C.S. Lewis was an atheist who didn't believe in God, didn't put his faith in God. And through community and through the power of the Holy Spirit, he gives his heart to Jesus. Maybe God is asking, you know that person at your job that's confused about their gender, would you have lunch with them? Oh, I don't know. You know, if I sit with somebody that's confused about that gender, am I affirming their lifestyle? And I would say to you, you're not sitting there affirming their lifestyle, but you can affirm that they've been made in the image of God, and the Holy Spirit can work through somebody's heart, and the Holy Spirit can save somebody that is gender confused. The Holy Spirit can save somebody that's an atheist. So I go in with this mindset, not with a lens of judgment. I go, Holy Spirit, you have the power to save this person, just like you saved me. Because can I just be honest? There were some of us in this room that were far from God. The last place that you were going to come on a Sunday morning was in church. But now you're here. Praise God, right? What if it's somebody that is not as well off as me? Maybe their socioeconomic status is, they don't belong in the same room with me. Maybe they don't earn the same money as I do, and maybe they've fallen on hard times, and now they live in their car, or they're homeless. Would I bring that person to my table and give them an opportunity to sit with me, or am I too well to do that? I can only invite those that are like me, that are at my social status, if you know what I'm saying. And you say to yourself, is the gospel good for everybody or only good for certain people? It can sound challenging, and I get convicted as well. It's like, who am I inviting at the table that is far from Jesus? I have to look at my walls and say, are there walls of judgment where I'll look at a person, cast judgment, and move on? And can I just say, if you have walls of judgment today, if there's walls up for people in society that God wants to save through you, you are limiting your effectiveness for the kingdom of God. And you're saying, God, why don't you use me? You go, God says, I'm trying. Maybe there's somebody at your job says, God says, I want you to bring them to the table. The church itself is this opportunity to break down walls. Why? Because Jesus broke down the same walls. In Ephesians 2 and 14, it says this, for he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. What is Paul saying? In Ephesus, it was a pagan culture. You have many cultures in Ephesus, but God was saying in Ephesians 2 through the Apostle Paul that we once were natural enemies. Now we are the family of God. Can you take a look around your seats? Thank God that we don't look alike. Thank God we don't think alike. Thank God that we're not the same. Thank God that we're not from the same culture. I thought I would get a little bit more excitement, but that's okay. Thank God anyway. That we are a multi-generational church. We're not all the same age, thank God. I love my, I don't call them senior saints, I call them seasoned saints. I get in trouble. We thank God for our young adults. We thank God for our middle. We thank God, why? Because we're a multi-generational church. Can I just say, if the church was made up of people just like you, I wouldn't want to go to your church. Only like you, let me rephrase that. Like I wouldn't want to go to a church where everybody thought like me or acted like me. I thank God that we're a church that we're not all the same color. That we come from different ethnicities and we come from different cultures. So I love my Caribbean folks. Can I get a hallelujah from my Caribbean people in the house? My Latinos, anybody? My Italians, anybody? My Asian, my African. Anywhere else I missed? What you see right now in the seats and in all of our campuses is a picture of heaven where every tribe and every tongue and every nation will be gathered around the throne of God. And to be honest, there will be, based on your invitation, or there will be people that you may notice today that are in bad shape, that will surprise you that they made it to heaven. You'll be looking at them like, you made it? The last time I saw you? You were kind of messed up. Yeah, but somebody invited me to their table. Invited me into a relationship with God. So I want to say to you, even today, you are not too far from God that he cannot reach you. So Levi says, hey, I'm not going to keep this to myself. I'm going to have a banquet for Jesus. But here's the thing. Levi, say Levi has social media. Levi's sending out group texts. Yo, his social media page is blowing up. His Instagram, his TikTok, his Facebook, whatever social media. And he's like, guys, listen, I gave up the tax collecting business to follow Jesus. Now you can imagine all the tax collectors following Levi on his feed. You did what? You gave up all your wealth, your lifestyle to follow who? Jesus. Man, I gotta go check that out. And what was Levi thinking? Hey guys, out of all culture in the world, out of everyone that hated you and I, there was one man that looked at me differently one day that made me want to give up everything to follow him. And it's the same for us. When you look at sometimes the things that you are holding on to, when God says to follow me, the things that God is saying to exchange, God wants to provide something better, but sometimes we're holding on to the things and God is like, would you just surrender that to me? I got a better plan. And they all gather at this banquet. And this large crowd of tax collectors and others were eating. So I want you to think in South Florida, I want you to think about maybe the places that you wouldn't normally go. Maybe it's a club you used to frequent or a sports bar. I don't know. But I want you to think about the places in South Florida, South Beach, that's just partying and drinking and all of this stuff going. You go, man, I'll never go there. You know, I'm a Christian now. I want you to picture Jesus and his disciples in the middle. They're not partaking in the happy hour, like the world, but they're in the middle of tax collectors and others. And here's the reason why we break down walls. It's so that we can build relationships. The second point is this. The table is a place for building relationships. So as we sit at the table, it's a banquet. Levi's probably got that big house because he's a tax collector. He's been earning good money. He can fit all of these people in his house. And now all these tax collectors and sinners are sitting with Jesus at the table. So when you're building relationship with somebody, now I have that person that's different than me. Now I have that person that doesn't think like me. And here's the thing. Can I just say, Christian, I love my Bible believers. I love the fact that you love Jesus. I love when you say, hey, how you doing? I'm blessed and highly favored. I love all of that. But when you have somebody that is far from God, that is not the time for you to say, well, let me give you all the 50,000 verses that I've memorized since I became a Christian. They're over there saying, man, I just came to eat and they bombarded me with the Bible. Not to say that this is not relevant, but you go from noticing them to now being interested in their story. Well, why do you think that way? Oh, you had trauma. I was abused. Oh, okay. There's parts in the Bible where it says Jesus was moved with compassion. And so you look at them with this lens of, how do I get to know your story? Why don't you believe in God? And you begin to understand them. And they begin to value the fact that now you have this relationship with them. And as you eat and as you prepare meals, it's disarming. Eating lowers your guard. As you take every bite of the meal that's prepared, it's like the next bite, you're, okay, tell me more. Tell me more. Tell me more. And when you think about meals that you cook, how many people like to cook in the house and cook here, right? And so when you're preparing your meal, let's just say it's a meal that's like your specialty, it's your go-to, I don't know what it is. Maybe for you, it's lasagna, maybe it's stroganoff, maybe for me, it's oxtails. Can I get an amen on the oxtail, somebody? I'm trying to get the grill to change their menu. Nobody's cooperating with me. But the effort you put in that meal, because of the people that you've invited to the table. Back in the day when my mom would make something, or my wife now, who's an amazing cook, will say, girl, you put your foot in that meal, man. And this meal, the guest of honor is Jesus. And we said it in the past weeks, Jesus is a foodie. Anybody know what Jesus' favorite food is? Soul food. Anybody? You'll catch it, some of you. I know some of y'all didn't have your coffee yet. I get it. Soul food. Jesus is not concerned about the collard greens as much as he's concerned about the soul that needs to be saved. It's not about the meal. It's about what's happening at the table. And this power in this dynamic at the table, when somebody sits across from you, there's a power in that. And I was thinking about even my family table. And I didn't realize the power of our table at home, the Roberts family, how attached I was to that table until we started talking about giving it away. And I was telling my family, man, this table means so much. I mean, my kids grew up at that table. There's conversations that we had at that table. We talked about Jesus at that table. We talked about life, like how was school today at that table? That table is where we ate. And now that my kids are older, we talk about life at that table. And I was thinking about the relationships and the power dynamic of having somebody sit across the table from you. It is so disarming when I don't feel judged at this table. All I'm doing is having a meal with somebody that values me and values my company. And to be honest, when we're thinking about somebody that is different from us or far from God, I can't sit over here and say, my life is so perfect. Why? Because there are no perfect Christians. Can I get an amen? So as much as I am looking for God to work on that person, he's still working on me. Yeah, we can praise God like that. His work doesn't stop. So it's to build relationships. It's not about the Bible verses, but it's about getting to know the person. We say this all the time, and I don't know if you've heard this before. People don't care how much you know, but they want to know how much you care. And what does those conversations look like? In Colossians 4 and 5, it says this, Colossians chapter 4, verses 5 and 6, it says, be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Outsiders, make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. What is the Apostle Paul saying? When I have conversations now, the idea is that my conversations are seasoned with salt and full of grace. I know how to engage the person that does not believe in Jesus before I invite them to the table. And I look at our Christmas invites and I think about evangelism today. And don't get me wrong, I believe in the gospel going out. I believe the church is called to share the gospel. But I believe that more than the power of an invite, the power of relationship is so awesome. What do I mean by that? I can tell you the amount of times that I've handed out Christmas invites and Christmas Eve invites and Easter invites and Resurrection Sunday invites, and not many people have come to my church or my campus on an invite alone. So when I engage my neighbors, recently we had a neighbor that just had a baby and they recently got married and we begin to share in the joy. And I told the couple, my wife and I are praying for the health of your baby. This is when the baby was pregnant. When the baby was born a couple of months ago, we're saying we're still praying that your baby grows up. And now we have this beautiful family. You know, this woman was crying in the middle of her driveway over that interaction. And I say to myself and I say to you today, the work of the Holy Spirit's not limited to what takes place here. It's can happen at your job, it can happen at Publix, it can happen at the gas station, it can happen in your community, it can happen anywhere. We just gotta be ready to move when the Holy Spirit desires us to move. Can I get an amen, somebody? We just gotta be ready to build these relationships. I think when we look at evangelism, it is relational. Why? Because these are relationships that will last into eternity beyond the meal that we have. Imagine someone walking away from your table saying, wow, I thought Christians were weird. I thought he was going to pound Jesus on me, but they just noticed me and heard my story. Without judgment. What if we just did that? Maybe it's even today. You might have somebody that's new to the church. You're sitting in your same spot, but you notice somebody different sitting in that spot. Hey, I notice you're new. What's your story? You want to go to the grill? You want to go to the generous cafe? Just have a cup of coffee? Let this not end with just the series. Let this be something that it becomes something that the church embodies. Saying God is always putting people in my path to share his love, to invite into a relationship with him. Let's continue, verse 30 through 32. It says this, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law who belonged to their sect complained to his disciples, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? If you were to look up that original word, sinners, it is anyone that is prone to do evil. And Jesus is in the middle. The Pharisees complained. And many times we can complain about the culture. And we say this, and don't get me wrong, I pray you don't misunderstand me. Jesus, when you're coming back, please come back soon. This world is getting crazy. And Jesus is like, no, I got more people that I'm inviting into my kingdom, so I'm going to keep you there for a little while longer so God can still use us because he wants to continue to add to the kingdom. How many of you still have family members that don't know Jesus? How many people want God to wait just a little bit longer? Friends that don't know Jesus that you are praying for, interceding for. Philippians 2 says, we don't grumble and complain, but we shine like lights as we hold out the word of God. Verse 31, Jesus answered them, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Last point, if you're taking note, is this. The table is a place to introduce people to Jesus. And here's Levi. Levi's inviting people because he wants to introduce them to Jesus. And so let's say this is your table at your house, or maybe it's the lunch table at your job, or maybe you invite somebody at your job that you're like, Lord, I wish they would finally fire that person. And God's like, they're not going to be fired because I need you to share the gospel with them. So stop complaining. Who's at the table with you? Jesus. And after you hear their story, you testify to your story. And so maybe there's a person that's over there that's dealing with anxiety, that's dealing with an addiction, and God has placed you there. Why? Because your testimony identifies with the one that he's building for them. Amen. And you say to yourself, wow, I didn't just invite you, but now I'm getting revelation as to why God chose this person to sit across from me. And then you say to yourself, can I introduce you to a man named Jesus? When I was down and the world hated me and I felt alone like Levi, and I didn't have any answers or hope, can I introduce you to somebody that saved my soul when I was in some dark places? Can I just tell you, you don't have to be perfect to be saved by Jesus. Actually, we will never be perfect enough to be saved. God's grace saves us anyway, not because we did anything or we earned anything. He just pours out his love on us. And so we invite them, but we also introduce Jesus to them. And like I said, the Pharisees were just like, oh my goodness, how? And it boggles my mind that the Pharisees, who knew the scriptures, who knew the Old Testament, who had the words of the prophet, were supposed to know when the Messiah came, but they didn't. And so instead of them bringing people closer to Jesus, they were actually pushing people away from Jesus because they were full of religion. And I want to just tell you that right now, the world does not need more religious people. The world needs more people that invite someone into a relationship with God. So they're busy complaining. And it reminded me of the story at our campus. Somebody said to me after the service, I can't remember when it was, he says, hey, pastor, we really need to tighten up our security around here. And I go, why? He said, the person I sat next to was smelling like marijuana. And I said, really? And I processed that, and I said, but of all the places they could be, they decided to come to church. Yeah. And so the person that is probably saying to himself, man, if I go to church, maybe I won't be addicted to the marijuana. Maybe I won't be addicted to the drugs. Maybe I won't be addicted to the alcohol. If somebody would just connect with me, if I can just find you, God, and they end up at one of our campuses. But just imagine that person's experience. They're sitting there and we do this. They got a smell to them. I don't know if I could worship God with people smelling around me. Can I just remind you, you had a smell before you knew Jesus. You smell like the world. You smell just like your struggle. And now the same church that's not good enough for them, but was good enough to save you, is now not good enough for the person that smells like where you came from. So what if somebody was to walk in here that didn't smell good? Would we do this, or would we take the chair and be like, welcome to Calvary Chapel. I'm so glad you came. Never seen you before, but we're glad you're here. We pray you enjoy the worship. Oh, the word is awesome here. And there's hope to be found here. And then after service, you walk up to them. How was the service? Oh my gosh, I felt not judged. I felt like I was welcome. I belong. And you know what you say to this person? Hey, next week, there's a seat. We want you to come back next week. In fact, what's your name? Can I take you out for coffee next week to get to know your story? Jesus said, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick of any malady, anything that you can think of emotionally, spiritually, physically, any malady that says that the crowds were coming in droves to be healed by Jesus, to be made whole. And that is the opportunity that I feel that we have as the church. It's why do we reach over the wall? Why do we build relationship? Why? Because we want God to save them, but to heal them of whatever malady and brokenness and shame and things that they've carried, things in their past, all of that stuff that continues to define them. We want them to find hope so they can be healed. Praise God. So here's where that comes into play. It's Luke chapter 5. We're going to go back to the man full of leprosy. Verse 12, it says, while Jesus was in one of the towns, a man came along who was covered with leprosy. When he saw Jesus, he fell with his face to the ground and begged him, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. I am willing, he said, be clean. And immediately the leprosy left him. Then Jesus ordered him, don't tell anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them. Yet the news about him spread all the more so that crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. I want to give you the context. And there's a reason why I'm landing there with the story. If anybody was far from God in Jewish culture, it was the leper. The story says his skin was full of disease and he was extremely contagious. And so he was an outcast. Not allowed to go to a church, not allowed to go to synagogue or work. Basically, he was a walking dead man. And anytime he would come back into town, say he had to come back to buy groceries or whatever, somebody had to go ahead of him with a bell and say, unclean, unclean. You imagine what type of life this man led and lived? And in many times, we are like the leper. Don't think that we come to church and we're always clean either. And he gets on the ground having enough faith. He is not supposed to approach Jesus. And he begs him and he calls him Lord because he knows that out of everybody in Jewish culture today, at least Jesus would pay attention to my condition. And he begs him, Lord, if you are willing, would you make me clean? And I love the words of Jesus. It says, Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. He says, I am willing. He said, be clean. And immediately the leprosy left him. Can I just tell you this? Jesus could have healed him with a word. But he touched him when he was not supposed to. I want you to get this. The man has probably not been touched for years, but his Savior touched him. Can we thank God that sometimes our Savior just touches us right when we need him most? Some of you today simply need a touch from Jesus. It's like the woman with the issue of blood. She just said, I just need the touch of the hem of his garment. And here was the reason why no one wanted to touch the man, because the skin disease was so contagious, they thought that if I touched him, all of his impurities, all of his leprosy would actually come to me. But when Dr. Jesus touches you, when the great physician touches you, he doesn't take all of your impurities, all of his righteousness and his cleanliness and his purity gets transferred to you. So I think about the leper who knew he needed a doctor. And he goes. He didn't just need physical healing, but he had the faith that he also knew that he needed spiritual healing, because you need both. I mean, God could heal you physically, but more importantly, we need spiritual healing. Why? Because we have this sin malady that we need God to get rid of. So he knew he needed a doctor, and he goes to a doctor, which reminded me of a doctor that my wife has been witnessing to as a nurse. And she was talking to him for years. And he was a doctor that performed procedures, and he knew about Jesus, but his heart wasn't ready yet. But one day, like Levi, he was just like, to my wife and I, I'm ready to give it all up to God. And we recently did a private baptism for him, and he's like praising Jesus, and he's like, so praise God. So maybe some of you today know you need the doctor, and you're just like, okay, am I gonna have an opportunity to be touched by Jesus? And you will during our communion time. But there's some of us that know we are sick and need a doctor, but we won't go. Anybody? My wife is in the medical field, and a lot of times she goes, babe, you need to go to the doctor. And I go, I'm fine. I'm doing okay. Some of you will hear a message about the love of Jesus, but you'll say, nah, I just want things to work out. If they don't work out, then I'll try Jesus. And in Revelation 3, God is knocking at the door, but he will never kick it down. It says, for the one who opens, I will come in and die, but God will never kick down the door of your heart to follow him. And then there's some that don't realize they're sick and won't even acknowledge the doctor. That's the Pharisee. They see the miracles, but they won't acknowledge that the Messiah is in the midst, the great physician that heals and saves is in there. And then there's those that don't know that they're sick. And as you invite them to the table, you introduce them to Jesus. That trauma that you're dealing with, the great physician, Jehovah Rapha, he can heal you of that past trauma. That addiction that you're struggling with, that divorce, that scar that you still feel because your marriage didn't work out, that prodigal child that you're praying for, the fact that you made all of these financial mistakes, whatever your malady is, because sickness didn't have, it covered every category. Whatever your issue is, can I introduce you to a Savior that's willing to make you clean? Like he did the leper. You think Levi didn't realize he was sick? Sometimes it's not the physical sickness. Sometimes it's the heart that needed to be changed. Whatever made Levi decide to go into the tax collecting business and to be viewed as a traitor to Jew, something in his heart was off. So it doesn't necessarily mean that all of our external world is going right. You have wealthy people just as much as the unwealthy that still need Jesus. So maybe it's the business guy that has put all of his chips in the fact that his business is successful. He needs Jesus just as much as the person that doesn't have a house to sleep in. So I introduced him. You introduced him to Jesus. Why? He's Jehovah Rapha. If you're hungry, he's the bread of life, right? If you need forgiveness, he's the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world, that saves our soul. If you need deliverance, he's the deliverer of our soul. If you need redemption, he's a redeemer. If you need restoration, he can restore all the years that the locust has eaten. He's a God that does all things, so it doesn't matter what you bring to the table. God is willing to make you clean. So that's why we invite people. I want to give you some homework. Now, who loved homework when they're at school? Be honest. Like, give me more homework. Like, I love. Some of y'all saying, when is Doug coming back? Doug doesn't give me homework. We can't have you around too much. Once or twice a year, maybe. But I want to leave these couple of things for you to process as you go out from this service. First question I want you to ponder, do I notice people around me who are different from me and far from God? Now I want you to go out in the context of what you live in, where you live, and I want you to notice people and pay attention. And maybe ask God, have you placed this person in my path on purpose? And maybe a lot of times we're looking for the easy ones. God is like, no, I needed to reach that one. We think about our vision for the one, for the one. Who's that one? That God's saying, I need you to invite them to your table. Second thing I want you to think about, and this is internal processing, are there walls in my life that need to be broken down so I can build relationships? What are the walls of judgment? Do I look at people through the lens of judgment? Or do I look at them as being made in the image of God, and God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, can save that person that may seem far from him? But the issue is not them, the issue is me. And third, who can I invite to my table that needs to be introduced to Jesus? Because when I invite people to my table, Jesus is at the table with me. And as I hear their story, I sit down and I say, I'm so glad you told me your story. For all the things that you said, there's a God that died on the cross for you. He shed blood so that your past, your present, and your future sins are taken care of. It is finished. All that stuff, you can come to God right now. And as we look at taking communion, we're going to remember that sacrifice, not for just the person that's far from God, but also remember it for us. Can I get an amen this morning? Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you that you invite us to the table. Not that we deserved it, but you saw fit to invite us anyway. And God, I thank you, there's room enough at the table for every soul that is here. God, maybe there's someone that just needs the invitation to know who you are, to join the ones that already know who you are as we celebrate communion together. So Holy Spirit, would you move in our midst and give people the freedom to come. The Spirit and the Bride says, come. So asking God for people to just come and partake today. And it's in Jesus' name I pray, amen. I'm gonna read a passage of scripture, but before I read, if you are in need of communion elements, you didn't receive one, our ushers will get some to you. I want you to get them prepared. But I also want to make sure I extend an invitation to anyone that hasn't given their heart to Jesus. And the idea is we don't want you to take this communion element without having that relationship. Paul says that when we take this element that remembers his sacrifice, we condemn ourselves because we don't have a relationship with God. But here's a perfect opportunity for you to invite Jesus inside your heart. Here's the idea. You just say to yourself, God, something spoke to me today, and I want to invite you in my heart to save me. I want to be clean, and I invite your Holy Spirit to help me follow you the rest of my days. And if you pray that prayer, you can raise your hand and partake in communion. Because here's the scene in Revelation 19. The marriage supper of the Lamb, which is the ultimate table, Revelation 19, verse 6, it says, "Then I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like the roar of rushing waters and like loud peals of thunder shouting, 'Hallelujah, for our Lord and God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear.'" Then verse 9 says, "Then the angel said to me, 'Write these, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb.'" And he added, "These are the true words of God." So what we partake right now presently is setting us up for the marriage supper of the Lamb that we will take in the heavenlies. So let's just process together. Go with God. I love for us to just wait after the song is sung, and let's partake of the elements together. But go and have your opportunity to just access the presence of God. If something spoke to you, if you want to just say thank you, let's just spend some time thanking God together for his sacrifice for us.
I was a beggar outside your door, that's when your mercy sought me. And I was a prodigal, desperate for more, but that's when your mercy called me. Oh, what an honor to die with the King, here in your presence, surrounded by glory. I can't believe there's a seat at the table for me. This is my family, this is my home, always belonging and never alone. I'm so excited that we're all invited to come. So come, come, and taste and see. The Spirit and the Bride say come. Oh, come, and taste and see. The Spirit and the Bride say come. Oh, come, and taste and see. The Spirit and the Bride say come. Oh, come, taste and see, yeah. Oh, what an honor to dine with the King, here in your presence, surrounded by glory. I can't believe there's a seat at the table for me. This is my family, this is my home, always belonging and never alone. I'm so excited that we're all invited to come.
If you would, take out the wafer that represents the body of Jesus. Let's bow our heads together as we pray and remember what God did for us. Thank you, Jesus, that you were willing to be beaten, spat upon for the world. So God, as we partake of what represents your body, we are grateful for what you were willing to do, even when we didn't deserve it, that we didn't have to be perfect for you to die, but you died anyway because of your grace. So, church family, let's partake together of the body of Christ. And as we prepare the cup that represents his blood, God, we thank you that your blood covers us as far as the east is from the west. So far are our sins removed from us. And God, that we can stand before you blameless because you've not only covered our past, but our present and our future. Tetelestai, it is finished, paid in full. So let's partake together of what represents the blood of Jesus. And God, we thank you for the empty grave, because on the third day you rose again. And now you're seated at the right hand of the Father. And one day we'll get to be in your presence forever and ever, where there'll be no more death, no more sorrow, no more sin, just us in the presence of Jesus. And we cannot wait. We cannot wait until that day, Lord. So thank you that our best days are not behind us, but ahead of us. So come, Lord Jesus, come. Save, redeem, heal, cleanse. Holy Spirit, have your way in your church and in South Florida. We pray this in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Can we thank God right there? He's worthy of our praise. Would you stand to your feet? As we close in worship, I want you to say this with me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Now I want to follow you all of my days. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. God bless you. Thank you. We'll see you next week. If you need any prayer, we'll have prayer partners up here for anyone needs additional prayer for anything. God bless you. Thank you for coming.